morning and welcome to the cross. It is wonderful to be here this morning. I am Pastor Richard. For those that have not yet met me, I am the new assistant pastor here at the cross. For any first-time visitors, guests, we'd love to be able to connect with you. For those watching on Facebook Live, we want to be able to say that you're welcome to join us in person as well. And next week, we're going to do something special. If you've got a favorite sports team apparel, make sure you wear it. I don't know if there's any Colts fans here or not, but there might be a few. Also, you're able to continue to purchase your cross apparel on the website. If you need instructions on how to do that, you can go right out to the welcome table, and they can point you in the right direction to be able to order. Also, Wednesday evening for our Bible study at 7 p.m., Pastor Martin is going to begin a new series focusing upon Lent and upon Jesus going to the cross. Also, this Wednesday at 7 p.m., I'm going to be at, again, a young adult class. So if you've graduated from high school all the way up to whatever age you feel like you're still a young adult, we'd love to be able to welcome you. And also, I think there's something about a... how many of you like cupcakes? Here we go. Let's see who it's... The first drawing is... Did I create suspense? Joe Halterman. And we got one more to draw, so hold on. Chelsea Fields. So we'll make the announcement as well in second service for those that have been picked. Let's continue to worship.
Good morning, everyone. Our call to worship today is from Lamentations chapter 3. I remember my affliction and my wandering, the bitterness and the gall. I well remember them, and my soul is downcast within me. Yet this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. I say to myself, the Lord is my portion. Therefore, I will wait for him. The Lord is good to those whose hope is in him. Let's stand today and worship our Lord.
Sleeping, Lord, you were working on a mess I made like only I can do. When I start thinking I'm so far from you, I wake up to hear you whisper, that's not true. Good morning, mercy. Shining on my face, living's good, this side of grace. I feel it working. Goodbye to the hurting. You wake me up, put me on my way. Hallelujah, it's a brand new day. Good morning, mercy. Yeah, I'm still learning to trust and follow. Tomorrow's gonna bring, 'cause you hold it all there in your hands. I'm lifting mine up now, 'cause it makes me sing. Good morning, mercy. You call me worthy. Feels like the sun shining on my face. Living's good this side of grace. Mercy. me sing good morning. Good morning, mercy. You call me worthy. Feels like the sun shining on my face. Living's good this side of grace. I feel it working. Goodbye to the hurting. You woke me up, put me on my way. Hallelujah, it's a brand new day. Good morning, mercy. Good morning, mercy.
Jesus, that just the time that we need him the most, he is there, that he never leaves us, nor does he forsake us. This morning, as we go to the Lord in prayer, may we be able to approach the throne of grace. to be able to know that indeed that he is here and that he hears the concerns of his people. The altar is open to be able to come before the Lord and to experience that amazing grace. Unfailing love of a gracious and good God. Father, we thank you, Lord, that in the time and the moments of despair and times of loss, times of anguish, Lord, we can cry out to you to be able to think of King David and for the Psalms that he wrote, for he knew who we could cry out to. That he knew that he had a God in heaven who was never far away but sticks closer than a brother. Father, we pray for each one that has come to the altar, Lord. For each heart that clings to you within the sanctuary. Father, you know the things that we release to you in Jesus' name. to be able to know the hope and the victory that is found through the blood of Christ. Father, we thank you that we can cling to the cross, for that is our hope, and that is where the atonement took place. And as we prepare our hearts into this season of Lent, and as we look forward to the cross, but most of all for the empty tomb, to know the power of the resurrection, that we can come to you in prayer to be able to know that we have a risen Savior, and that indeed that he is in the world today. Father, we pray continually for the Walker family, Lord, for Missy, Lord. We pray that you'd continue to wrap your loving arms around her. We continue to remember our sister Trinda, Lord, and we pray that you just continue to touch her body, bring forth healing. Father, what a joy it is to see Margaret here this morning, and for the months that she's been down, Lord. Father, we thank you, Lord, that you have picked her up. And God, we pray for the many other concerns, for the unspoken, Lord, and for those that we know all too much about. And God, we are thankful that we can lay it at the feet of the cross. We can lay it at the Good Shepherd. We can bring it to the Savior. We thank you, Lord, for prayer. And we pray this in Jesus' name.
No shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, tear down, coming after me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it. I was a wretch, I remember who I was. I was lost, I was blind, I was running out of time. Sin separated, the breach was far too wide. But from the far side of the chasm, you held me in your sight. So you made a way across the great divide, left behind heaven's throne to build it here inside. And there at the cross you paid the debt I owe, broke my chains, freed my soul. For the first time I had, for the blood applied. no sting and life has no end. For I have been transformed by the blood of the Lamb. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood of life. Thank you, Jesus, it has washed me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life and brought me from the darkness into glorious light. There is nothing stronger than the wonder-working power of the blood. The blood calls us sons and daughters.
If you have your Bibles and you want to turn along and read with me today, we're looking at the book of Matthew, chapter 5. The book of Matthew, chapter 5. Can I say thank you, Pastor Richard? It's great to have you here. Thank you to be a part of this, and thank you for being here to help. Definitely needed help, and I'm glad to have you here, and I'm thankful for your part that you're going to be doing here for the kingdom. At the cross. Thank you. We've been talking about Jesus coming on a mission to share the truth. And we've been talking about the Beatitudes. To have a blessed life. Not a blessed life in the sense of you're going to get a bunch of new car, new house. If you do these things, you'll get a fat bank account, all of those type of things. We're not talking about that. But what Jesus is saying by blessed, you're going to live a good life. You're going to live a life that is going to bring you joy and more happiness than what we think by materialistic blessings that we can receive. That even in the midst of all of our suffering, in the midst of everything that we're dealing with and struggles, you're going to find joy. Joy that is welling up deeper in our souls than anything this world can give us. That as we apply God's truth in our lives, we are being transformed. We are being remade. And that is a joyous thing. We are coming to life. We were dead in our sins. But now, as we begin to change our attitudes, get that attitude adjustment, as we would say to our kids a lot of times, for those who are parents, you need an attitude adjustment. That attitude adjustment inside of us, as we apply God's word and God's truth in our hearts, it changes us at the core, and we come alive in Christ. And so we've been talking about these Beatitudes. And today we are at Matthew 5:7. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Very simple. Very simple beatitude, but probably one of the hardest ones to do. Especially with sin. Especially with sin and sin's effect and what sin has done to us. Sometimes it is very hard to be merciful because sin makes it hard to be merciful. I was thinking as a kid growing up in the 1980s, there were a lot of great movies in those generations, you know, a lot of great classics, a lot of things we watch over and over again. And there was this one movie I remember my parents, they brought home the VHS, you know, tape from the rental store. Some of you younger people don't understand what that is, you know. That was a great night when mom and dad come home from Blockbuster or whatever movie store, and you had the videotape and you had some popcorn and you got to sit down and watch a movie. And I remember this movie was about a young kid who moved into a new town. And he was having a hard time because some of the people in the town, some of the kids in the town, were bullying him. And he meets this older Asian man who teaches him not just how to polish a car. I'll say it with me. I know you're going to want to say it. Come on. Wax on, wax off. All right, there you go. You know we're going in the right direction. But Daniel Russo, and he learns karate. And of course, the villains in there was Johnny. And Johnny was a part of a dojo. Do we remember the name of that dojo? Cobra Kai. Yes, Cobra Kai. And at the end of the movie, of course, he does that famous move. Okay, let's see if I can get my balance. Give me a second. Do the crane kick, you know. That's what, we know that scene. Okay, we know that scene. The crane kick. And of course, he wins. But do you remember the motto of Cobra Kai? Does somebody? Strike first. Strike hard. Yes, there we go. Strike hard. And no mercy. I think a lot of us, because of what sin has done to us, we kind of abide by that motto, even though that may not be what we've learned. That sin nature causes us to be members of the Cobra Kai, whether we think we are or not. Dojo. It's because it's easy to strike first if somebody you know is going to strike you, right? We don't want that we want that element of surprise. And if they strike first, then we strike back. And how do we strike back? We strike back hard. We strike back hard so that they realize we're not somebody to mess with. And we show no mercy, especially to our enemies. Why would we show our enemies mercy? We were made in God's image. From the very start in Genesis 1, it says, "Then God said, let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish and in the sea and the birds in the sky and over the livestock and all the wild animals and over all creatures that move along the ground." So God created mankind in his own image. In the image, he created them, male and female. He created them. See, the thing is that we have this sense that we've been created in God's image, and so God has imprinted those things that he is in us. And one of those things is God is a God of justice. And so we have this sense, an idea of justice with inside of us. And so we struggle when an injustice is done to us, or to those we love, or even those around us in the world. And what sin does is because why we struggle with that injustice, sin begins to speak into our hearts to tell us that we ought to strike first, strike hard, show no mercy. Sin takes that idea of justice and we need to seek vengeance because of it. Because an injustice has been done to us or someone we love or even somewhere in the world. And even further, sin makes us selfish. It makes us selfish, so we begin to think about our own self, our own self needs. So it's not just the injustice that may happen to us and we strike out on that, but also because we're selfish. And if somebody has got something that we want, sin says, why don't you take it? Why don't you be jealous about it? Why don't you be angry? Why don't you fill your needs first? Why don't you take what has been given to you and use it just for yourself? What's the need to show mercy to other people? And then the third thing, sin can make us mean. Can I just say that? And even if we're the nicest people, we could probably think of times when we were just plain mean. And we were just plain mean to somebody that we should have been nice to. We were just mean because we had no real reason other than the fact that that sinful nature inside of us just came out. Callousness of the heart. That's what sin does. It makes our hearts callous. For this people's heart has become callous. They hardly hear with their ears, and they have closed their eyes. Otherwise, they might see with their eyes, hear with their ears, understand with their hearts, and turn. And I would heal them, Jesus says. In our hurts, in our brokenness, in our anger, in our disappointment, unresolved things in the past, we could just keep piling it on and on inside us. It makes us callous. Sin turns those things inside of us and makes us callous to the world around us and those who need just as much mercy as we've been shown. Because here's the thing, God had all the rights to, but, I want to put that there for a minute. I want you to think about that for a minute. God had all the rights to, but. God is a holy God. We believe that, right, this morning? God is good. There is no evil within God. We believe that. We believe that, holy. God is all-seeing. All-knowing, all-hearing, all-present. We believe that, right? God is in this place this morning. He hears everything that is being said. He sees everything that is happening. So if you're sleeping, he sees it. Just let you know. I don't have to say anything. If your phone rings, he hears it. Okay? So you should have silenced it. He's present. He's present in this place today. That's what we believe. So God is all holy and he knows everything. All right? God is a God of justice. We said that just earlier. God is a God of justice. He will only let evil go along so far before he intervenes. This means that God is perfect in his justice. Because he is perfect in all his ways. There's no hypocrisy in God. Okay, there's no hypocrisy in God. God is all these things at once, and these things make him be able to be without hypocrisy. The problem is we have hypocrisy in us, don't we? Because of sin, we are not perfect as God is perfect. So we struggle with hypocrisy. That's why Paul said this in Romans 7, "For I do not do the good I want to do, but the evil I do not want to do. This I keep on doing. Now if I do what I do not want to do, it is no longer I who do it, but it is sin living in me that does it." This one's a doobie-doobie-doo because of all those doos there. It's hard sometimes. Some of these scriptures are hard to read. Not because of the words. I mean, yeah, you go back in the Old Testament with some of the list of names. Those are tough. But sometimes they just some things that doesn't roll off your tongue very easily. You got to be careful. Here's the point. God knows the full story. Just like Paul Harvey, if you remember him from the radio, he'd tell you one part of the story, and then later he says, "And here's the rest of the story." His judgments are just because he knows the whole story. Our judgments aren't always just because sometimes we do not know the whole story. That's why Jesus told us, "Do not judge, for you too will be judged. For in the same way you judge others, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured to you." But it's hard, isn't it? It's hard not to judge. Because guess what? We have that image of God in us. And so God is a good judge. He wants to judge. We think that we can judge. The problem is we can't judge with the knowledge that God judges. We want justice, but our justice is bent towards us rather than full justice, where he sees the whole picture. And this morning, God is love. God's love flows through his holiness and his judgment, his justice, and his judgment too. Do you realize that? Sometimes I think we take God apart like we're looking at one of those pictures of the body, and here's the heart, here's the lungs, here's the bones, here's the muscles, here's this part, this part, this part. And we think separately. But all those parts work together continuously right now, right? My brain is speaking to my hands, and it's moving my hands and my body around. It's telling my heart to pump, my lungs to breathe. All of that is working together simultaneously, and it's the same thing with God. When God gives a judgment, it is out of his holiness and his love. When God does an act of love, it is out of his holiness and it's out of his judgment. We have to realize that. God had all the rights to. God had all the rights to judge us for our sins. All the rights. You go back to Noah. He was ready to destroy the whole world because the evil had gotten so far. We know that there's evil today, and we know that evil seems to be prevalent, but it was there in Noah's day to the point that God was ready to put judgment on the whole world, wipe them all out, and he found one who was righteous. God has the right to judge us for our sins. God has the rights to leave us to our own destruction. God could have said, "You know what? You don't want to listen to me? Go ahead. Do what you want to do. Good luck with that." God had all the rights to punish us for what we have done. But in God's holy, just love, he shows mercy. He loves us. The Father sent His Son out of love for us. Jesus showed mercy by taking our sins to the cross. Because of His great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, listen, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. Listen to what Paul says in Titus. He has saved us, not because of righteous things we have done, but because of His mercy. Because of His mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit. Now, folks, there is going to be time when Jesus comes again. And when He does come again, He will judge. And at that time, there will be no more time for God's mercy. His judgment will come complete. And in fact, He will show mercy on this world. Even though we might not think it, we will show mercy when He shows His judgment, because evil will be done with forever. And sin will be finally done forever in its effects. But until then, He is showing His mercies daily to those who are in sin, that they might come to Him so that they might not face Him in judgment. Remember that. There is a time of judgment that is going to come. There is a time when everyone will stand before the Lord and we will be judged. And we will be rightly judged because He is the right judge. But until then, His mercy is abounding every day. And folks, there is freedom in mercy. We found our freedom in Jesus Christ and the mercy that He showed us on the cross. And there is freedom in mercy this morning. Mercy brings us to a blessed or joyous life because we no longer have to be chained to anger, bitterness, unforgiveness. We no longer have to be chained to the need to be right or make it right by our own sinful nature. We no longer have to be chained to the hurts of the past. And because we have those hurts of the past, it makes us lash out. We no longer have to be chained to the selfishness of sin. It begins by handing over these things that I just mentioned. Handing those things over that keep us from being merciful to our Redeemer, to the One who has shown us mercy. We begin by saying, I'm a mean person, Lord. Be honest. Lord, I'm a selfish person. And because of that selfishness, I haven't been really kind with the people around me or shown love. I've been angry. I've been bitter. I've been unforgiving. And Lord, I know those things really hurt. And I know in my own self, I feel there is this right to be right. But it's not about me being right in that feeling. It's about You showing me mercy and me doing what my Father has done for me. Working with the Holy Spirit to process and deal with them. It's a process, folks. Can I say it's a walk? It's a walk in mercy. It doesn't just happen overnight. There are sometimes, man, it may take multiple nights of endless prayer to let go of some of those things that are really entrenched in us. You know, I think you think of a cavity in a tooth. Sometimes they have to drill. And man, sometimes they drill for a long time. And you're like, okay, enough. Haven't you hit it yet? Haven't you hit the core of it? And you hear the grinding and the spittle and everything's going everywhere, you know. Why do I do that? That just triggers my own, you know, anxiety thinking of that. But it takes a while to get to that core. And it's sometimes painful. But if we want to truly be joyous and happy, we have to begin to work with the Holy Spirit in order that we might show that mercy that has been shown to us to other people. Then move to action. After we've been working for a while with the Lord, we don't sit there and work with the Lord for years and years and years and not be moved to action, because in the end, that really isn't doing anything inside of us if it's not a call and a move to action. There has to be, at some point, going from here to here to here. The old mind, heart, hands. This means forgiving, where forgiveness is needed. To be willing to say, I forgive you, even though the world tells me I shouldn't. My friends tell me I shouldn't, and they tell me often. I need to forgive you. And then also, I think there's a time where apologies are needed to be given as well. That act of restoration and mercy of saying, I was wrong. I'm sorry. It not only frees you, but may free that person who's been angry. And it might be a work of kindness and mercy to them, because they can begin the process of forgiving and moving on. Showing God's love even when you are being wronged. That's a little harder. That's a little bit harder. But listen, in the Old Testament. This is in the Old Testament law. If you come across your enemy's ox or donkey wandering off, be sure to return it. If you see the donkey or someone who hates you fallen down under its load, do not leave it there. Be sure to help them with it. That's in the Old Testament. Do not gloat when your enemy falls. When they stumble, do not let your heart rejoice. That can be hard sometimes. You know, we want to see our enemies fall. No mercy. But not to gloat. Not to let your heart rejoice at those who may have caused us pain at one time. Fail. Here's Jesus. If you have heard it, you have heard that it was said, love your neighbor but hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemy and pray for those who persecute you. And if that wasn't enough, let's bring Paul into this. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, it is mine to avenge. I will repay, says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. And if he is thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Then we need to show mercy to those in need. This counters that selfishness inside of us that keeps us from being merciful. To show mercy to those in need. See the brokenness in the world around us. Jesus saw the brokenness. He was moved multiple different times when he saw the brokenness of this world and reached out in mercy. We too need to be reaching out to show God's kindness to those in need. Celebrate Recovery shows kindness to those who are struggling with hurts, habits, and hang-ups. Matthew's Market shows mercy and kindness to those in our community that is without food. And believe me, it's more than just handing out some food. If you go over there and you're a part of it, you will see people who come in and it's like a family. They come in and they talk and pray and share. I was over there Thursday and, you know, we got to pray for one lady who was struggling with some things. And then it was so neat. This one lady came in. She was so excited to see Amy because she wanted to share her good news that she got a job. And she was just, it was like a time of rejoicing over there. Show mercy. This world needs a little bit more kindness, doesn't it? Think of it as a little bit more kindness from the church to people around. We show mercy and kindness by standing up for those who have an injustice done, who have a need, and we meet it. What were the people in the Old Testament that God told the Israelites to make sure to be kind to? The poor, the widows, the foreigners living in their lands, people who could not be able to do anything on their own but needed the mercy and kindness of God's people to help them. We ought to be the same. As we show mercy, we will be shown mercy. As we show mercy, we will live a blessed life because mercy will be shown to us even more. And God's love will be poured out in us that we might be able to pour out to those around us. We're getting ready to take communion this morning. Communion is a reminder of what Jesus Christ did for us. It's a reminder that Jesus came out of mercy to die on the cross for us. And as we take communion this morning, I want us to begin to think and to begin to allow the Holy Spirit to speak to us and begin to tell our hearts, where are the areas where maybe we need to show a little bit more mercy? Where are the areas that God's mercy is needed in the community around us, the people that God has put around us? And how ought we do better to show that mercy? In the Wesleyan Church, we do not require you to be a member of the church in order to take communion. But we do ask that you have received Jesus Christ in your hearts out of faith, and that you are living a life that is walking along in relationship with Jesus Christ. And if you do not have that relationship, but you are willing today to cry out to the Lord in prayer, to admit that you have sinned against him, and out of faith believe that Jesus Christ has saved you from your sins, you can receive communion with us today. The ushers would come forward this morning. And as the ushers come forward, I want to remind you, please hold on to the cup and the bread until we have it together so that we can eat it as one body this morning. Listen to Paul. For I received from the Lord what I also pass on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whoever eats this bread and drinks this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Let's pray. Lord, we are about to take communion. You gave us this so that we might remember together as a body the sacrifice that you were willing to make for us. Our sin had a cost and you were willing to pay for it. Willing to show us mercy when we hated you. You showed us love first. So Lord, I pray right now we just take a moment, and as we take this moment, if there is something within us that we just need to hand over to you before we take communion. Lord, I pray you would convict our hearts. Lord, we would offer up in faith repentance to you this morning. I pray right now that you would just bless this time of sharing with the bread and the juice. Speak to our hearts as we receive it today. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. the body of our Lord Jesus Christ that was broken for you. Receive it in remembrance today. The cup of juice that represents the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ that was shed for the remission of our sins. Receive the cup today. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for your word. Now, Lord, as we go out, bless each and every one. May they feel you close this week. May they see the great things that you are doing around them. And Lord, may they be your hands and your feet to the people around them. Bless them today, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you please stand? Praise God, from whom all blessings flow.